Agriculture and education investments take center stage in Washington's trade and investment mission to Manila. One of the companies participating, Aviagen, which specializes in breeding broiler stock, says it's looking to expand its distribution network in the country. It says a feasibility study is ongoing to potentially establish its own operations while continuing to support its local distributors. Meanwhile, Northwest Missouri State University plans to mount an exchange program with Manila through scholarship program, saying the country has a, quote, strong return on investment in education. The trade mission, which happens 5 months after it was promised by U.S. President Joe Biden to President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. during his Washington visit, is the first of its kind for the Philippines. The delegation first came to Davao City to forge stronger ties with the private sector and Filipino farmers. The Philippines expected to grow the fastest in 2023 among developing economies in East Asia and Pacific, beating Vietnam. That's even after the World Bank slashed its forecast for the country. Jackie Pascual has this report.
After the Asian Development Bank trimmed its growth forecast for the Philippines from 6 to 5.7% this year, the World Bank, too, has lowered its annual growth projection for the country from 6% in June to 5.6% in October. The global financial institution cites the economic slowdown worldwide, elevated inflation, and growing debts of many countries.
The big concern has been slowing global growth. Philippines, like all the countries in the region, depends on the rest of the world for its exports of both goods and especially services. And also, a lot of Filipinos work abroad and send their remittances back.
The forecast is also lower than the Philippine government's target of between 6 to 7%. Even Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno has said that the government may revisit its growth targets this year. Despite that, this 5.6% growth projection for the Philippines is still among the fastest in East Asia.
We expect economic activity to be supported by domestic demand, to be led by private consumption, and the decelerating inflation is good news.
The Philippine Franchise Association is also optimistic of growth driven by the pent-up demand domestically, saying total revenues of the industry could rise by 10 to 13% this year or hit at least $33 billion for 2023.
2023, we can start seeing things recover, especially in the food sector. Retail naman has been recovering. Next year, we see some of the services at least opening up.
We really feel that we are going to grow, especially with this last quarter of the year. We believe that there are more Filipino brands that will go abroad.
But the officials admitted there will still be challenges, such as the high prices of raw materials and low agricultural output, which also affect many of franchise firms' supplies.
All of us are trying to absorb a lot of the price increases, but there's only so much you can do. Inflation, everything's rising, right? Whether it's gasoline prices, whether it's a lot of the input materials, whether it's agricultural materials.
The support of the government, we badly need support to the agricultural sector really, to be able to provide that. Increasing their production, the yield, and to be able to allocate more for production.
The group is hopeful the upcoming Franchise Asia Expo, which will be hosted by the Philippines this month, will give a boost to the local economy. About 1,000 brands globally will gather in Pasay City, and organizers hope it can entice more Filipino brands to go overseas. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Health Insurer claims it has settled 76% of its debt to hospitals. PhilHealth says as of the August 2 cutoff date, it has already disbursed 20.7 billion pesos in payments out of the 27 billion in hospital claims. The agency told lawmakers in a September 6 hearing it will pay majority of the debt within 90 days or 3 months. PhilHealth had said the delay in payments was caused by pandemic-related challenges. The health insurer recently suffered from a cyber attack, which it admits compromised its members' personal data. It's now working with the ICT department to strengthen its cybersecurity system. The Philippine Tourism Department rolls out its 24/7 tourist assistance call center that will address the concerns of travelers nationwide. Tourists may now seek travel assistance and file travel complaints through the contact details we're now flashing on the screens. So far, the system has 12 tourist assistance agents, but the DOT says they may add more if needed. Tourism Chief Christina Frasco says the agents underwent several training on emergency assistance, culture and service excellence, among others. Meanwhile, the DOT is optimistic the country will hit its target 4.8 million foreign tourist arrivals this year. As of September, nearly 4 million tourists have already visited the country. The approval ratings of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and Vice President Sara Duterte suffered double-digit drops in the latest Pulse Asia survey. We have more in this report.
Approval ratings of the two highest officials of the Philippines fall in the third quarter of 2023 based on the latest Pulse Asia survey. While continuing to enjoy majority approval scores, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s rating declined to 65% in September from 80% in June, while Vice President Sara Duterte's rating dropped to 73%. From 84%. Pulse Asia president and political scientist Ronald Holmes says the drop in the approval ratings was significant.
It's a large drop, basically, 15 points. So, mahalaga siguro natutukan nila yung maaring nagpababa sa kanilang performance rating. Kasi hindi naman pagkaraniwan to.
The survey, which covered 1,200 respondents, was conducted from September 10 to 14. While Pulse Asia did not ask respondents the reason for their ratings, Holmes surmises that the higher cost of commodities may have affected sentiment.
Makikita, for example, na tumaas yung headline inflation simula July hanggang Agosto. At maaaring ito ang nagpabigat sa mga mamamayan kasi tumaas ang presyo ng mga pagkain. At ilang mga non-alcoholic na inumin, particular ng bigas at ang mga gulay.
Holmes also observes such a drop in approval ratings was not present during the two previous administrations.
Hindi ganun kabilis yung pagbaksak ng approval rating ng nakaraang dalawang pangulo, maong pangulo si Noynoy Aquino at saka itong nakaraang pangulo si Rodrigo Duterte.
Holmes says former President Rodrigo Duterte's approval ratings only declined in September 2018, or 2 years after he assumed office, while Marcos Jr.'s ratings fell after only 1 year of being president.
Balance of Luzon, bumaba rin yung kanyang approval, no? 15 points yung binaba. So, ibig sabihin, hindi ganun katibay yung kanyang suporta sa isang lugar na napakaraming nakuha niyang suporta nung nakaraang eleksyon.
Meanwhile, Holmes clarifies that the survey period did not cover the contentious, confidential, and intelligence funds present in the Vice President's proposed budget, which was being deliberated in Congress. The same Pulse Asia survey found that half of adult Filipinos had a positive assessment of the work done by Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri. House Speaker Martin Romualdez obtained essentially the same approval and indecision ratings, while half of the respondents were unable to say if they approved or disapproved of the performance of Supreme Court Chief Justice Alexander Hesmundo. ABS-CBN News sought Malacanang's comment on the survey, but it has yet to give a response.
Sports equipment retailer Tobies urging the government to address what it calls an unfair playing field in the online marketplace. The company's chairman, Robert Claudio, says traditional retailers are at a disadvantage with online sellers due to tax issues and customs duties.
The retail industry is robust. However, we are encountering issues on the e-commerce side, on the online. Apparently, while the market's growing, the consumers are benefiting from online marketplaces, but government regulations has not cope up with the growth of e-commerce or online, especially online foreign merchants.
Right.
There are issues on taxation. There are issues on intellectual property, but I mean fake goods in marketplaces. Right. There are issues on consumer protection. All of these are issues that we'd like to address to the extent that this alignment is causing an unlevel playing field in the retail industry. So the inline stores are suffering from the onslaught of the online.
Meanwhile, Claudio bears his company's plans to list on the Philippine Stock Exchange as well as to expand overseas, with three Asian markets high on the list. He says they're still assessing the market and valuations, as well as identifying partners that will help the business grow. Artworks of renowned Filipino painter Fernando Amorsolo feel right at home in a Philippine gallery. But take a closer look at this exhibit in Makati and you'll see the early traders, Bayanihan and Dalagang Bukid, actually have a little Danish touch. Lego bricks, to be specific. Project Amorsolo is a handiwork of this Pinoy Lego users group whose members are enthusiasts of the popular toy. As you might expect, recreating the paintings was no easy feat, with each piece composed of thousands of Lego elements and requiring multiple people to accomplish.
Everything took 1 year to finish, from assembling everything to framing, then really delivering it at CCP for its initial launch.
Project Amorsolo has so far toured 21 venues and will be making its way to Quezon City in the near future.